So the next speaker is David Terrell. David is the Ross McCollum William Cochrane Professor of Chemistry and Chemical Engineering at Caltech. So David did his undergraduate in chemistry at MIT. And I'll let David tell you what the relationship is to Professor Merrill. And then went from there to get a PhD in polymer science at Amherst. And after a postdoc and a sojourn to CMU, returned to Amherst. And from there, where he became the director of the Materials Research Laboratory, as well as professor, obviously, of polymer science. And he's then went to Caltech, where he's survived being department head and is back in the lab. He has many honors for his many contributions to the polymer film. And I won't go through all of this, but I wanted to mention that he's a member of both the National Academy of Science and Engineering, as well as the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. And he has, as you might imagine, gotten many awards from the ACS. I mean, among those, the Arthur Cope Scholar Award and a number of the Polymer Science Awards at ACS Awards. With that, I'll turn it over to David.
Thanks, Klaus. I'd like to start with congratulations to Ed and with thanks to the department for arranging this symposium. It's a wonderful idea. I'm delighted to be included, and I certainly appreciate all of the effort that goes into arranging activities of this kind. It's great to be part of this this day. It won't surprise anyone to hear me say that Ed Merrill is, without question, the most influential teacher I've ever had. I'm a polymer chemist because Ed is a polymer chemist. I work on biological problems because Ed works on biological problems. And I teach the way I do because Ed teaches the way he does. I've said many times that had I encountered Ed as a teacher of something else, I would now be doing something else. I wanted to be whatever Ed was. The freshman class that arrived at MIT in the fall of 1970 consisted of 1,000 physics majors and me. I intended to study urban planning. But I have a brother whom some of you know. He was 2 years ahead of me. He was studying chemical engineering at Northwestern University and doing undergraduate research in polymers with Bill Gressley. When we'd go home for the holidays, he would tell me what he was doing, and I decided that I should learn something about polymers. Ed offered an IAP course on polymers in January of 1972, and I became a polymer chemist about halfway through his first lecture. I started undergraduate research in Ed's lab shortly thereafter, and I continued until I graduated in the spring of 1974. Ed did many things at that time that were important to me and have remained important to me over the years. His classes were lively, and his sense of humor and his flair for the theatrical were always on display. He would do demonstrations in which the simple pouring of one liquid into another became an adventure. I don't think we were ever in danger, but it always seemed as though something might go horribly wrong. He brought Paul Florey and Paul Rempe to MIT at that time, and he gave us opportunities to get to know them both inside and outside the classroom. He made me feel as though what I was doing in the lab was important, despite the fact that I was mostly breaking stuff and spending his money. And he made me part of a family that includes Nicholas Pepys, with whom I shared a bench for 2 years, Mike Sefton, who was around the corner, and Bob Langer, who came into the lab from time to time, people who've been my friends now for nearly 40 years. For all of those things, I'm very grateful. So I'd like to tell you some things that have been going on in my laboratory since I left Building 12. Ed taught me how to make polymers and convinced me that it was a worthwhile and interesting and satisfying thing to do. And for about the last 20 years, we've been using an approach to polymer chemistry in which we use artificial genes to direct the synthesis of artificial proteins in bacterial cells. We design sequences of amino acids that we think will give us interesting macromolecules. We encode them into complementary DNAs. We make those DNAs, and then we use recombinant DNA methods to get from the coding sequence to the polymer that's of primary interest to us. That means we take circular DNAs out of bacterial cells, cut them open, put the artificial genes back in. The recombinant DNAs are then reintroduced into bacterial cells, and those cells are grown in a flask or a fermenter under conditions where they'll make the polymer for us. And for somebody who comes from a polymer chemistry background, this approach to making macromolecules has some important and unique advantages. It's the only way that we get what is essentially absolute control of the molecular architecture, that is, the length, sequence, and stereochemistry of the chains that we make. To show you what I mean by that statement, we compare over on the right-hand side of the slide mass spectra of polyglutamic acids, which can be made either by a chemical polymerization process, the ring-opening polymerization of the anhydride, or by gene expression. If you do the ring-opening polymerization and you put those products into a mass spectrometer, you see all of the different chain length variants that I first heard about from Ed, and that arise from any chemical polymerization process where we always have competing initiation, propagation, and termination steps. On the other hand, if you make an artificial gene that encodes polyglutamic acid, you express it, isolate the protein product, and put that in a mass spectrometer, that's what you'll see. If you wanted the molecular weight to be about 9,000, you make the gene of the appropriate length, and you get molecular weight 9,000. If you'd like the chains to be twice as long or three times as long, you just adjust the length of the artificial gene. This method also gives us access to well-defined folded structures. It allows us very straightforward incorporation of functional sequences that can be derived from natural proteins. It allows us to amplify and evolve things if we don't get them quite right in the first place. And something that we didn't anticipate at the outset is that it's allowed us to develop some new approaches to biological problems, and that's actually what I'd like to talk about for the next few minutes. In order to attack those biological problems, though, it turned out that we needed to move beyond what nature gives us in terms of the starting materials for protein design. Nature builds proteins from just 20 amino acids, and that's enough to do molecular recognition, catalysis, to support all known forms of life, but it's not enough for a polymer chemist. And so much of our effort for the last 10 years has been directed toward diversifying the set of amino acid building blocks that can be used to build proteins in cells. This is the process that we refer to as reinterpreting the genetic code, the phrase that I used in the title of the lecture. I think probably everyone is familiar with the basics of the control mechanisms that make this chemistry interesting to us in the first place. That is, that we go from DNA to RNA to protein. The conventional view is that once the messenger RNA has been made in the cell, the genetic code will tell us what the sequence of the protein has to be, because each of the codons is assigned to one of the natural amino acids. And what I'll show you is that doesn't have to be true. It's relatively straightforward, in fact, to reassign codons to new amino acids and effect what we call alternative translations of RNA messages. That is, to give the genetic code a new interpretation. The way in which we do that is to control two fundamental steps that affect codon assignment in the cell. Amino acids are initially activated by aminoacyl tRNA synthetases. They're placed onto the 3' end of their transfer RNAs, and it's the aminoacyl tRNA that guides the introduction of the amino acid to the end of the growing polypeptide chain. This is the most stringent step in the process. Nothing that comes further downstream is likely to get in the way if you can get a non-natural amino acid onto its tRNA. And if you had a minute to think about that statement, you wouldn't find it surprising. The ribosome, for example, has to accommodate all 20 amino acids, so the ribosome can't be terribly selective. The synthetases, on the other hand, are adapted one by one to the individual amino acids. There are 20 synthetases in most cells. The second stage where you can intervene in the process is the decoding step, where codons and anticodons pair up to deliver the amino acid to the end of the chain. I'm not going to talk about that step at all. What I'd like to do is to show you some of the consequences of gaining control of the amino acylation step in the cell. By doing that, we've been able to introduce about 50 new amino acids that can be used by cells to make proteins. We concentrated in particular on the introduction of new chemistries into protein science and engineering. Natural proteins don't have any carbon-carbon double bonds, triple bonds, azides, halogens, strained rings, ketones, or any of the substituted aryl groups shown there. And one can, in fact, do lots of new kinds of protein science and engineering and other kinds of macromolecular science and engineering with access to this expanded set of building blocks. The color code on the slide shows you what you have to do in order to get the amino acid to go into proteins. If the structure is shown in black, you don't have to do anything at all. You just soak the amino acid into the cell, and it will go in competition with the natural amino acid. I'll talk a lot about this particular amino acid, azidohomoalanine. It's a methionine surrogate, so it's activated by the methionyl tRNA synthetase in the cell. If we deplete methionine from the cell, we can decode all of the methionine codons as AHA. If we don't deplete methionine, we get a set of protein molecules that are lightly labeled with azidohomoalanine. If the amino acid shown in blue, the wild-type synthetase also activates it, but very slowly, so we have to put in extra genetic copies of the wild-type synthetase. And if the amino acid is shown in red or shown in green, we have to use mutant forms of the synthetase. The first problem that I'd like to tell you about is this development of a new approach to analysis of protein synthesis in both microbial and mammalian cells. And for those of you who might want to think about the details of the work, the things that I'd like you to remember from this discussion are that it allows us to do that analysis in a time-resolved fashion and also in cell-selective fashion. And I don't think those two things can be done in any other way. We became interested in this problem through a conversation with Aaron Schumann and Daniela Dietrich, neurobiologists in the biology division at Caltech. Aaron and Daniela are interested in the molecular mechanisms that underlie the formation of long-term memory in the brain. In order to make long-term memories, we have to make new proteins. Aaron and Daniela would like to understand which proteins are made in the synapse when it's stimulated by various signals. This is a very hard analytical problem, because the synapse is already full of pre-existing proteins, and we'd like to see the first few copies of the first proteins that are made in response to the signal. It's a little bit like the problem over on the left-hand side of the slide. This is the synapse before it's stimulated. This is the synapse after. It doesn't look greatly different. What you need is a way to make the pre-existing proteins invisible. And if you do that, it's very easy to see the new one. So we needed to devise a method for making pre-existing proteins in the cell invisible to us and to allow us to harvest and analyze only the new ones. What we decided to do was to pulse label the cells with that amino acid that I mentioned a minute ago, AHA. If we add a pulse of AHA and new proteins are made, they'll pick up the azide side chains. And only the new ones will carry the azide side chains. The pre-existing proteins won't. So the new proteins will be susceptible to an azide alkyne ligation, which allows us to put on a biotin or a flag tag, something that marks those new proteins and allows us to separate them from the pre-existing ones. This is a procedure that we call BonCat. Ed, with his mastery of French, would object to that pronunciation. It should be bon chat, but we call it bon cat. Sorry. And so this is a general procedure for doing time-resolved analysis of protein synthesis. Any cell type full of proteins that you don't want to look at, is stimulated. It makes blue proteins that makes them easy to find. But we pulse in AHA, that gives us the azide side chains. We can then click on an affinity tag. Let's say it's a biotin. We'll pass everything down an avidin column. All the proteins that we're not interested in will be washed away. The blue ones will stay behind. We digest them with a protease and identify them by mass spectrometry. And this has actually turned out to work significantly better than I had expected at the outset. The easiest way to show this is to look at a Western blot. This is an experiment where proteins are separated by gel electrophoresis under the influence of an electric field and then transferred to a membrane where they can be probed with antibodies. So here we're using an anti-biotin antibody looking for proteins that have been biotinylated by that click reaction. We see hundreds of them. If we leave out the AHA and only put in methionine, we don't see much background. That tells us that the click chemistry is selective. If we inhibit protein synthesis, even if we have AHA in there, we don't see much background either. So we have to be making new proteins for this labeling to occur. In a typical experiment, when we run the samples through a mass spectrometer, we'll find several hundred proteins. In this experiment, we found about 200. In the control experiments, where we put in only methionine, we picked up 3 false positives. So this gives you a sense of the extent to which you can distinguish between newly synthesized proteins and the pre-existing protein pool. Sometimes you'd like to see where the newly synthesized proteins are in a cell or a tissue, in addition to identifying those proteins. So here we're looking at hippocampal slices, not just cell culture, but a slice through the part of the brain that's the most important part in developing memory. If you look at the panel at the lower left, this is a slice that's been treated with AHA and then with a fluorescent dye. And we can see that there's lots of protein synthesis going on there. We know that it's new protein synthesis because if we treat the slice in exactly the same way, but we've added protein synthesis inhibitors, we don't see much background. So you can tell what the proteins are, and you can tell where they are, not only in a cell, but in a complex tissue. That experiment raised an additional challenge for us, though. As you probably know, neurons are not the dominant cells in the brain. There are 10 glial cells for every neuron. So we don't want to have to sort through all the glial cell proteins in order to find those that were made in neurons. Can you restrict labeling to a particular cell type only to neurons? You can't do it with AHA because AHA is activated by the wild-type synthetase, which is present in every cell. What you need to do is to select an amino acid that requires a mutant synthetase that's not present in every cell. And then you put that mutant synthetase under control of a promoter that's turned on only in neurons. We haven't done that. I think in a couple of weeks we will have, but I'm going to show you a proof of principle here. Yeah, you've heard that before. Yeah. In fact, I said that a few weeks ago, if I recall. I think I said that in January. But The amino acid that we decided to use here was a thionylphenylalanine. We're going to do this in bacterial cells, which is a pretty good model for my neurons. The thionylphenylalanine is useful to us because it requires a mutant synthetase. We put it under control of an inducible promoter, and then we can turn that promoter on with IPTG. And so we're going to look at some Western blots very similar to the ones that we just saw a minute ago. We're going to be looking again for biotinylated proteins. The E. coli cell has one endogenous biotinylated protein. So when you take a background reading before you start the experiment at time point A, you should be able to find one endogenous biotinylated protein in the Western blot, and there it is. We then start the experiment by adding thionylphenylalanine at time 0. We look again 15 minutes later. 15 minutes is a long time in the life of a bacterial cell. It's a half a generation. Hundreds of proteins have been made during that 15-minute interval. We don't see them. We see only the endogenous protein because none of the synthetases active in the cell can activate thionylphenylalanine. So there's no way to do the click reaction on any of those newly synthesized proteins. We then induce the mutant synthetase, and we look again 5 minutes later to see if there's been any labeling. and that's what we see. Hundreds of proteins labeled in that 5-minute interval, and one can then take time slices to follow the consequences of activation of that promoter. We've been using this strategy in a slightly different form to look at a variety of other problems, for example, host-pathogen interactions. You may know that when pathogenic bacteria infect mammalian cells, they'll often inject a set of proteins into the mammalian cell to disable the cell, in large part taking apart its cytoskeleton. Those proteins are injected in relatively small quantities, if for no other reason than a mammalian cell is 2,000 times as large as a bacterial cell. And so this, again, is a difficult analytical problem where we're trying to be able to harvest rare proteins from the cytoplasm of the mammalian cell to try to understand the chemical warfare that goes on between those two cell types. So here we prepared a bacterial cell that carries the mutant synthetase. Those are shown in green. They've infected red mammalian cells that don't carry the synthetase. And then we've clicked on a green fluorescent dye, and you can see that the dye follows very nicely the bacterial cells attached to those mammalian macrophages. When we try to enrich bacterial proteins, we again do it by Western blotting. As a mammalian marker, we use beta-actin, and we can see that in the cell lysate, there's lots of beta-actin. We just make a mixed lysate of all the cells together. Lots of beta-actin. The bacterial marker is GFP. You can see it in the initial lysate, but we can enrich it by affinity chromatography to the stage where we've been able to eliminate any of the background that comes from beta-actin. And we're now trying to use this to understand the time course of that process by which the cells battle one another. The most exciting aspect of this work is the one that I said we haven't done yet, and that is to try to do this in a particular cell type, even in a live animal. We have preliminary results that I find very encouraging here. We're working in worms, fish, and mice. And in the worms, the work that we're doing with Paul Sternberg, we have a preliminary success where we've done the nonspecific labeling with azidohomoalanine and then a fluorescent coumarin dye that reacts with it. And one of the things that I found very exciting when I saw this image just a few weeks ago was the extent to which it reveals the internal structure of the worm, indicating that, in fact, the AHA is being cycled into a very large variety of the worm proteins. This suggests that when we do implement the cell-selective variant, that we should be able to get useful levels of incorporation. And again, the control experiment where we've put in only methionine rather than AHA shows that there's not much nonspecific background labeling. The last slide addresses a different subject, but a similar chemistry. This is work that's not going on in my own laboratory, but in a small company in Seattle called Allozyne. This is a Caltech spin-off. I am a founder of Allozyne. That's by way of disclosure. And I thought it would be especially appropriate to talk about this example here because it refers to a pegylation strategy, which Alan Hoffman told us about a few minutes ago, and where he highlighted Ed's very important contributions to the development of those strategies. What Allozyne is doing as its first area of focus is developing an improved form of interferon beta for the treatment of multiple sclerosis. Multiple sclerosis is the most common neurological disorder of young adults. It affects between 2 and 3 million people. It's an autoimmune disease and ultimately results in the loss of motor coordination. Because it's an autoimmune disease, it's treated by administration of interferon beta, an immune system modulator. But interferon beta has the same problem that most therapeutic proteins have. It doesn't stay in the circulation for very long. Certain forms of interferon beta have to be injected as frequently as 3 times a week. That leads to problems. First of all, there's the problem of compliance. People don't want to do it, so they often don't. And then the frequent administration results in the formation of neutralizing antibodies. The strategy that essentially the whole biopharmaceutical industry uses to address that problem is pegylation. But nobody's been able to prepare a clinically useful form of pegylated interferon beta. What Alezine decided to do was to make a variant of interferon beta where they introduced just a single methionine residue. They replaced it with AHA, the amino acid we've been talking about, and then they clicked on a PEG alkyne. In order to assess the performance of that construct, they use a tumor suppression model where tumor cells are implanted in mice and the growth of the tumor is followed over time. If there's no treatment, the tumor grows according to the green line. If the tumor is treated with beta-seron, one of the clinically used forms of interferon beta, 3 units, 3 times a week, you get some suppression of tumor growth. But with the Alezine pegylated interferon beta, you use 1 unit rather than 3, once a week rather than 3 times a week, you get complete suppression of tumor growth. So those data, along with many others, were persuasive to the FDA, and Alezine began its first clinical trial in August of last year. It's still a phase 1 clinical trial, so there's a long way to go, and many of us have seen examples where mice have been cured and no human patient has ever been helped by that technology. We may be in that situation too, or Alezine may be, but we're hopeful that in fact this chemistry will enter the clinic and will be helpful to patients who suffer from multiple sclerosis. And it will be another example of Ed's influence if that occurs. So I'm listing here the names of the people who did the work that I talked about. I'm not going to tell you what each of them did. It's a wonderful group of people to work with. And I do, in fact, every day in my interactions with them, emulate Ed's interactions with me. And I am very grateful for his influence and for his contribution to the field that all of us work in. Congratulations, Ed.
Wow.
Yes,
Alan. Question. Could you go back one slide?
Yep.
About the blue side and the green side.
Yeah.
And I'm also curious about the molecular weight and the branched or non-branched character of the PEG. What are you using?
Yeah, it's the sample that I talked about is a linear 40 kilodalton PEG. These are both also pegylated interferons using the same chemistry, but they're shorter chains. They don't work quite as well.
So the 40, and it's linear.
One copy of a linear 40 kilodalton chain.
Have you tried 220s?
No. Like my students, Alezine consistently ignores my advice. And this is actually very liberating because you don't have to worry about giving bad advice because nobody follows it. You just give the advice and you get out of town. And it's great. So I've advocated that 1,000 times and they've never done it. They're never going to do it. They just ignore me.
Buy more stock.
Other questions for David?
David? So is there a generic biochemical reason why that distinguishes those amino acids for which you need to manipulate the synthetase and those for which the wild type works?
You know, the simplest answer is just the size. You know, ordinarily we're adding bumps onto the amino acids and we have to hollow out a hole in the synthetase. There are some more subtle examples, though, if I can guess where that slide is. So most of them are a little bit bigger than the natural ones, but one that's not and turned out to be a very interesting problem to solve was oxynorvalin, which is a leucine analog. And it's essentially the same shape as leucine, but it carries this polar oxygen atom or polar carbonyl where leucine has a methyl group. There we actually had to shut down the editing activity of the synthetase. That's what's implied by the green structures. And it turns out that there's a threonine at the active site, at the editing site of the synthetase that serves as a hydrogen bond donor to that carbonyl. I think it's probably there to keep threonine out of proteins in response to leucine codons. So the synthetase has evolved not only an active site, but an editing site that'll take the amino acid back off again. And the primary threat, apparently, to the leucyl synthetase is polar analogs. And so once we knocked out that editing site, we could get oxonorvaline in. So there's no simple answer. It's kind of idiosyncratic.
Sam? Could we just revisit the specificity in the polyglutamic acid?
Yeah.
I'm guessing that otherwise it's Schultz-Flory polymerization.
Yeah.
Well, the thing that occurs to my mind is that one of the great unsolved problems increasingly important to us now is, of course, the reaction of synthesis gas to form hydrocarbons, Fischer-Tropsch synthesis. Mm-hmm. Highly unselective. You get every oxygenated byproduct that you can even think about, which is a problem. And I'm wondering if one can introduce in some material the specificity that you've introduced into polyglutamic acid mm-hmm. that therefore gets you the degree of polymerization you want of the synthesis gas to get to the fuel you want.
Yeah. You know, I think that's a very important and ambitious challenge for people who do these kinds of things. I think it's going to be a long time in coming. I think that reshaping catalysis, even in enzymes, has proven to be a very difficult challenge. Enzymes are already very good at catalysis. And so most of our effort, for example, has been devoted to changing other properties of the protein while trying to maintain their catalytic and recognition functions. So I think in the long run, there will be some successes of that kind, but I think it's a very long-range objective.
And that's why we're here.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.